So Hegel opens the introduction to the phenomenology by considering an epistemological picture according to which our cognitive faculties are regarded as the instrument by which, or the medium through which one discovers it. Philosophers otherwise as diverse as Descartes, Locke, and Kant can be seen to work with versions of such a picture. It seems clear that Hegel thinks we need to break out of such a natural way of thinking about knowledge. In my first lecture, I tried to say why and indicate in general terms the shape of a new picture that he will recommend to succeed this traditional one. The broadest form of his objection to theories of this of the kind he's complaining about is that they make us patsies for skepticism. More specifically, he thinks that modern epistemology is conducted within the scope of semantic assumptions that make it impossible in the end to satisfy what I call the genuine knowledge condition. And that's the requirement that epistemological theory not make it unintelligible that, at least when all goes well, how things appear to us is how they really are. In his terms, that how things are for consciousness can be how they are in themselves. And I argue that the crucial feature of the class of theories he takes to fail this requirement by precluding the intelligibility of general knowledge is not that they construe the relation between appearance and reality in representational terms. It's that they take the termini of the relation to be characterized by a structural difference. Representing appearances are construed as conceptually articulated, while represented realities are not. Theories with this shape excavate a gulf of intelligibility, separating knowing from the known, mind from world. Of all the differences that there might be between the known, between how the known world objectively is and how the knowing subject represents it, why should one think that this possible difference makes such a difference? Why would it matter if thought, but not the world thought about, is construed as coming in conceptual shape? Hegel's working in a Kantian idiom, in which there's an internal connection between conceptual articulation and understanding. Concepts are the form of apperceptive awareness. So what can be understood, what's intelligible, just is what's in conceptual shape. And Hegel thinks that unless the picture has it, that we can understand how things really are, any relation we assert between these realities and the appearances we can understand or grasp must itself be unintelligible. No relation to what's ultimately and intrinsically unintelligible, because not conceptually articulated, could count as a cognitive relation, a relation of knowing. It couldn't be the basis for an account of knowing that makes sense of the possibility of genuine knowledge. This is the problem with the idea of, quote, getting the truth in its purity simply by subtracting from the result the instrument's part in that representation of the absolute which we gain through it, as Hegel says. The result of subtracting its conceptual form from our understanding would be something unintelligible. We can't understand the relation between what's intelligible and what's not intelligible for the simple reason that we can't understand what's not intelligible. A picture of that sort can't satisfy the genuine knowledge condition. Again, in the first lecture, I suggested that the key to the alternative picture Hegel wants to put in place lies in his non-psychological conception of the conceptual, which he introduces and develops in the consciousness chapters of phenomenology. According to this conception, conceptual contents are articulated by relations of material incompatibility, his determinate negation, or exclusive difference, Aristotelian contrariety. This line of thought begins with an understanding of determinateness that applies equally to thoughts and things. It's codified in Spinoza's dictum, omnes determinatio est negatio. Both that there is some determinate way the world is, and that a thought has determinate content, are to be understood in terms of the possibilities that they exclude. A state of affairs whose obtaining would rule out the obtaining of no other, a thought whose truth would rule out the truth of no other, would be indeterminate, unbestimmt. The kind of negation in terms of which determination is understood, in Hegel's version of Spinoza's thought, is that characterizing relations of what he calls exclusive, ausschließend difference, as opposed to indifferent, gleichgültig difference. That is, it's the relation between properties of circular and triangular, not that between circular and red. This way of understanding the metaphysics of determinateness is by no means idiosyncratic to Hegel. Besides its Spinozist and indeed scholastic antecedents, it's the master idea behind contemporary information theory, which understands the information conveyed by a signal in terms of possibilities its receipt excludes for the recipient. And it can be understood as another way of expressing the understanding of a proposition as a partition of possible worlds into those compatible with and those incompatible with its truth. But what warrant is there for thinking of the metaphysical conception of determinateness in terms of material incompatibility as a conception of the conceptual? Justifying that identification requires giving an account of two defining characteristics of the conceptual. First, one must show how to justify, in its terms, the Kantian identification of intelligibility in terms of conceptual form by saying what it is to grasp or understand something that's in conceptual form in this sense of conceptual form. And second, one must show how what is conceptually contentful in this sense also exhibits representational purport. These correspond to the two dimensions of intentionality I distinguished last time, that intentionality and of intentionality, what one can say or think, and what one would thereby be thinking or talking about. My second lecture addressed exactly these two issues. Starting with the notion of conceptual contents as articulated by relations of material incompatibility, they stand into other contents. It showed both what one must do in order thereby to count as cognitively grasping such contents, and how doing that amounts to practically acknowledging the representational purport of those contents. Grasping or understanding a conceptual content is engaging in the process Hegel calls experience. This is Hegel's successor conception to Kantian apperception. For Kant, what one must do in order to apperceive, to be cognitively aware, is to judge. Judging, in turn, is understood as rationally integrating a commitment into a developing whole that exhibits the distinctive synthetic unity characteristic of apperception. That unity is a rational unity with critical, amplitude, and justificatory dimensions corresponding to the normative obligation to exclude materially incompatible commitments, acknowledge material consequences, and assess justificatory credentials. The contents commitments must possess in order to be subject to these rational normative obligations must accordingly stand in relations of material incompatibility and consequence to other such contents. Grasping or understanding such a content is practically being able to distinguish what's materially incompatible with it, what it conceptually excludes, and what's a material consequence of it, what it conceptually includes. And what it's a material consequence of, that is what conceptually includes it. And this is just to say that it's necessary and sufficient to be graspable in this sense, to be apperceivable, that the contents be determinate in the sense of standing to one another in relations of determinate negation and so mediation. What's determinate in this sense is in conceptual form, in Hegel's sense. In the introduction, Hegel focuses on one dimension of the process of apperceptive experience, the experience of error. This sort of experience is occasioned by finding oneself with materially incompatible commitments. Practically acknowledging the error is exercising one's critical task responsibility to repair it, removing incompatibility by relinquishing, or at least modifying, at least one of those jointly incompatible commitments. In the previous lecture, I explained how it is in the experience of error that representational purport is practically taken up. That is, that determinate, hence conceptually contentful commitments, are taken or treated as representations, as appearances of some reality. Incompatible commitments must have some common topic. For if two or more properties are incompatible, what's impossible is that they should be exhibited by one and the same object at the same time. If one attributes incompatible properties to two different objects, one has not yet made a mistake. To take it that one has made a mistake, that the commitments are incompatible, is to take them to refer to or represent one and the same object. In the second phase of the experience of error, the subject responds to the acknowledgement of error by fulfilling the critical task responsibility of repairing the incoherence by amending or discarding one of the commitments. Doing that is treating the amended or discarded commitment as a mere appearance, and the retained and resulting commitments as expressing how things really are. In this way, through the experience of error, the distinction between what things are in themselves, reality, and what things are merely for consciousness, appearance, becomes something to consciousness itself. That distinction is practically implicit in the process that is the experience of error. This is how consciousness incorporates as a basic aspect of the structure of its functioning, a practical appreciation of its determinate subjective commitments as purporting to represent how things really objectively are. It treats its commitments as about things in the sense of answering to how things are in themselves for the correctness of how they are for it. So Hegel Spinoza's concept of determinateness in terms of articulation by relations of modally robust exclusion, material incompatibility, or determinate negation, meets the principal requirements for a meta-concept of conceptual contentfulness. It makes sense of what it is to grasp a conceptual content, and of what it is for such contents to have a representational dimension. Furthermore, the way these two criteria of adequacy are satisfied are deeply connected. In the context of Hegel's structural critique of traditional modern epistemology, the key explanatory virtue of this non-psychological conception of the conceptual is that it applies not only to subjective thoughts, but also to objective facts. For both are determinate. They're determinate ways consciousness takes things to be, and they're determinate ways things are. And they're both determinate in virtue of standing in relations of material incompatibility to other ways one could take things to be or things could be. But the subjective and objective senses of material compatibility are not identical. If two states of affairs are materially incompatible, then it's impossible for both to obtain. But if two thoughts or judgments are materially incompatible, it does not follow that it's impossible for one subject to be simultaneously committed to both. It only follows that the subject ought not to be so committed, that such a subject is obliged to do something, to change the situation, to fulfill the standing critical task responsibility to rectify the situation by eliminating the incoherence. On the side of objects, incompatibility of properties is an alethic modal matter of impossibility. On the side of subjects, incompatibility of commitments is a deontic normative matter of impropriety. But the notion of material incompatibility or determinate negation that comes in these two flavors is not simply ambiguous. For what one must do in order thereby to count as practically taking or treating two objective properties or states of affairs as objectively incompatible is precisely to treat the corresponding commitments as normatively incompatible, in the sense that finding oneself with both obliges one to change one's commitment in acknowledgement of an error. Treating two commitments as incompatible in the deontic normative sense is representing two properties or states of affairs as incompatible in the alethic modal sense. What one must do in order to manifest practically one's grasp or understanding of conceptual contents is suitably engage with them in the practice or the process of experience, especially the experience of error, by fulfilling one's obligation to resolve acknowledged incompatibilities. Doing that is treating incompatible commitments as representing incompatible states of affairs. The relation between the sense of materially incompatible, then, that's articulated by deontic normative relations of what one's obliged or entitled to do on the subjective side of representatives, or of what things are for consciousness, and the sense that's articulated by alethic modal relations of what's necessary and possible on the objective side of representatives of what things are in themselves, is one of reciprocal sense dependence. It's not that there cannot be objective properties and states of affairs standing in relations of modal incompatibility to one another unless there are representatives of them. It's rather that one cannot understand what one is saying or thinking in saying or thinking that they stand in such relations, except as part of a larger story that includes what subjects who represent them as so standing, by practically acknowledging their normative obligation to do something to repair the situation when they find themselves with commitments to objects having incompatible properties. And one cannot understand the nature of the obligation to alter one's conceptual commitments when they turn out to be incompatible, unless one understands them as representing objectively incompatible situations. This relation of reciprocal sense dependence is responsible for the Janus-faced character of Hegel's meta-concept of determinate negation. On the one hand, it characterizes the aletheic modal relations that, as Kant had taught, structure the objective world. On the other hand, it characterizes the norm-governed subjective processes or practices that is experience, which is always inter alia the experience of error. In the latter aspect, it's not a matter of static relations, but a dynamic matter of movement, change, and development. That one cannot understand the most fundamental structure of the objective world apart from understanding what one must do to represent things as being so is an essential element of Hegel's idealism. One can put the point by saying that objective substances, no less than subjects, things no less than thoughts, as determined, are essentially conceptually structured. But unless one keeps in mind the complex fine structure of Hegel's Janus-based non-psychological conception of the conceptual in terms of determinateness as articulated by materially incompatibility, one will not understand what's meant by such a claim. Well, that's where I take it I brought us to so far. The greatest hermeneutic challenge in reading Hegel's introduction clearly lies in the three paragraphs that precede the final one. In Miller's numbering in his English translation, these are paragraphs 85, 86, and 87. And the principal reason for the handout is because these last four paragraphs of the introduction, essentially all those passages, are on your handout. For here, Hegel makes two claims that are surprising enough to be worth quoting at length. The first is introduced with the observation, which I think we put ourselves in a position to understand, that in the experience of error, the subject, consciousness, quote, is consciousness of what to it is the truth, and consciousness of its knowledge of this truth. Since both are for consciousness, consciousness itself is their comparison. Whether its knowledge of the object corresponds or fails to correspond with this object will be a matter for consciousness itself. End of the quote from 85. The subject assesses the material compatibility of its commitments, exercising its critical, rational task responsibility as a judger. Where an incompatibility is found, a choice must be made. One commitment can still be endorsed as presenting how things really are, in themselves. But then others must be unmasked as mere appearances. They're now implicitly or practically treated, they are to it, as he says, as presenting how things are for consciousness. Recall here the crucial distinction that I pointed out in the previous lecture, that Hegel marks grammatically between what things are implicitly to consciousness, using ihm, and what they are explicitly for consciousness. In the example from the previous lecture, seeing its behavior when the half-immersed stick is fully removed from the water, the subject discards her commitments to its being bent and substitutes a commitment to its being straight. It's only slightly hyperbolic, then, to say that the consciousness that is the subject of this experience, as Hegel does, quote, is their comparison. Quote again, something is to it in itself, but the knowledge or the being of the object of consciousness is to it still another moment. It's upon this differentiation, which exists and is present at hand, that the examination, Prüfung, is grounded. And if, in this comparison, the two moments do not correspond, then it seems that consciousness will have to alter its knowledge in order to bring it into accord with its object. That's the end of the quote from 85. That is, after the discordance has been repaired and material compatibility restored, the appearance, what things are for consciousness, should, as far as consciousness is concerned, that is, to it, have been brought in line with reality, with what things are in themselves. But that's not how Hegel wants us to understand what happens in such an experience. He says, quote, "In the alteration of the knowledge, however, the object itself becomes to consciousness something which has in fact been altered, as well. For the knowledge which existed was essentially a knowledge of the object. With change in the knowledge, the object also becomes another, since it was an essential part of that knowledge. Hence, it comes to pass for consciousness that what had been to it, the in itself, is not in itself, or what was in itself was so only for consciousness. When, therefore, consciousness finds its knowledge not corresponding with its object, the object itself will also give way. In other words, the standard of the examination, the Maßstab, is changed if that whose standard it was supposed to be fails to endure the course of the examination. Thus, the examination is not only an examination of knowledge, but also of the standard used in the examination itself." End of the quote from 35. Now, this is very odd. Why should we think that when a commitment the subject took to express how things really are, a presentation of how things are in themselves, that's what it is to the subject, is revealed as expressing really how things are for consciousness, why should we think the reality changes? When I realize that the stick I took to be bent is really straight, my view of the stick changes, but the stick itself does not. That I took it to be bent is not, in our ordinary way of thinking, an essential feature of the stick. Surely the contrary claim does not follow from what one might justifiably claim, that its object, the stick, was an essential feature of the appearance the stick has bent. The stick serves as a standard for assessments of the correctness of my commitments as to its shape. In what sense does that standard change when I realize that my shape commitment does not measure up to the standard, that it gets things wrong? Hegel's claim here seems extravagant and perverse. The argument he offers, quote, for the knowledge which existed was essentially, basically, a knowledge of the object. With change in the knowledge, the object also becomes another, since it was an essential part of this knowledge. End of the quote. That argument appears to trade on an obviously unwarranted slide. Even if we grant that what it's a claim about, what it represents, is essential to the identity of the claim, so that altering the represented object would alter the content of the claim, it just does not follow that the content of the claim is correspondingly essential to the identity of the represented object, so that altering the content of the claim alters the object. Being essential to is not, in general, a symmetric relation. So, for instance, we might think that the identity of my parents is essential to my identity. Anyone with different people as parents would be someone different from me. It's not possible for me to have had different people as parents. But when we look at the converse, it does seem possible that my parents might never have had any children, or only had some of the children they did, not including me. Essentiality of origins of humans does not entail essentiality of offspring. It's easy to see Hegel here as engaging in a sleight of hand, attempting to smuggle in an unobserved and implausible idealism that makes what is thought about essential to the identity, that makes what is thought about it essential to the identity of what is thought about. But as we'll see, that would be a misunderstand the claim that he's making. The second surprising claim is introduced as part of an account of the basic structure of experience in the distinctive technical sense that Hegel introduces here. He says, quote, "The dialectical movement, this dialectical movement, which consciousness exercises on itself, on its knowledge, as well as its object, is, insofar as the new, true object emerges to consciousness as the result of it, precisely that which is called experience." This is from paragraph 86. The challenge posed by the earlier passage is echoed here. how are we to understand this movement, which he says consciousness exercises, on the object of its knowledge? The key question will turn out to be this. When commitment to the stick is bent, is discarded, and replaced by commitment to the stick is straight, what exactly is the new true object? Answering this question correctly is integral to understanding the sense in which, on Hegel's account, the representational purport of conceptually contentful commitments is itself something to consciousness, something implicit in its own process of experience. In order to understand the justification for saying that the experience of error changes not only how the subject is committed to things being, the stick is now taken to be straight, not bent, that is, consciousness is knowledge, but also changes the object of that knowledge, the essential point to realize is that the new true object which emerges to consciousness is not, for Hegel, the straight stick. After all, it didn't change. It was straight all along. So it's natural to think, when we give up the idea of the stick being bent and replace it with the stick being straight, and Hegel was describing that as the process of a new true object emerging in consciousness, that the new true object is the straight stick. And that's exactly wrong. That's what we have to understand in order to understand why those earlier passages I read are exactly what he should be saying and not peculiar in the way that they appear on the surface of it. Hegel describes the experience like this, quote, consciousness knows something, and this object is the essence or the in itself. But this object is also the in itself for consciousness, and hence the ambiguity of this truth comes into play. We see that consciousness now has two objects. One is the first in itself, and the second is the being for consciousness of this in itself. The latter seems to be merely the reflection of consciousness into itself, a representation not of the object, but only of its knowledge of the first object. But as already indicated, the first object comes to be altered for consciousness in this very process. It ceases to be the in itself and becomes to consciousness, an object which is the in itself only for it. And therefore, it follows that this, the being for consciousness of this in itself, is the true, which is to say that this true is the essence or consciousness's new object. This new object contains the annihilation of the first. It's the experience constituted through that first object. End of the quote from 86. The first thing to note is that the first object is described as the first in itself. That implies that there's at least another in itself. But there's only one real stick, and it's straight. The key to understanding this is that what's at issue here is the role something can play in experience. The role in question is being an in itself to consciousness. To be an in itself to consciousness is to be what consciousness practically takes or treats as real. At the beginning of the experience, the subject in question endorses the claim that the stick is bent. That's what the subject takes to be real. The bent stick commitment expresses the first in itself to consciousness, how it initially takes things really objectively to be. The second in itself to consciousness is expressed by the later straight stick endorsement. But what then is the second object being talked about in that long passage? It's not the straight stick, which is the second in itself to consciousness. Hegel says here the second object is the being for consciousness of the first in itself. What does that mean? When he introduces the movement of experience in the previous paragraph, Hegel says, quote, hence it comes to pass for consciousness that what had been to it, the in itself, is not in itself, or what was in itself was so only for consciousness. What the subject discovers is that what it had taken to express the way things really are, the stick is bent, actually only expresses an appearance. The role the bent stick representation plays for consciousness, what it is to consciousness, has changed. It, quote, becomes to consciousness an object which is the in itself only for it, close quote. The new true object is the bent stick representation revealed as erroneous, as a misrepresentation of what is now to the subject, the way things really are, a straight stick. This representing is true, not in the sense of representing how things really are, but in the sense that what is now to consciousness, that what it is now to consciousness is what it really is, a mere appearance, a misrepresenting. That's why he says, quote, this new object contains the annihilation of the first. It's the experience constituted through that first object. That's quote. This is the sense, so where you might think that the new true object that emerges in experience is the straight stick, in fact, the transformation is just of the bent stick commitment, which changes status from being to consciousness what things are in themselves to being to consciousness only what they are for consciousness. So it's the change of status of that bent stick representation that he's saying, focus on that. Don't focus on the replacement of the bent stick with the straight stick. Focus on the change of status of the bent stick representation from being to consciousness what things really are to being to consciousness only what it had represented them to be, how it had appeared to them. This is the sense in which, quote, in the alteration of the knowledge, the object itself becomes to consciousness, something which has in fact been altered as well, close quote. What alters is the status of that bent stick represented, what it is to consciousness. It had enjoyed the status of being to consciousness, what the stick is in itself. But now its status has changed to being to consciousness, only what the stick was for consciousness, an appearance. Understanding that the two objects are the bent stick representation when it was endorsed, and the bent stick representation when it's no longer endorsed, we're now in a position to see that on our first reading, we misunderstood the knowledge of the object in the argument. And we're saying, look, this looks like a terrible argument that he's making. That's because we weren't thinking about what the object was that he's saying has changed. That object is this bent stick commitment. He said, quote, for the knowledge which existed was essentially the knowledge of the object. With a change in the knowledge, the object also becomes another, since it was an essential part of this knowledge. What is knowledge to consciousness is what's endorsed. What the subject practically or implicitly takes to be how things really are. What has to consciousness, the status of knowledge, changes in the course of experience, from being the stick as bent to being the stick as straight. This was knowledge of the object, not in the sense in which a representing is of something represented, but in the sense that the status, being to consciousness knowledge, was possessed or exhibited by the object, the bent stick representation. That status was possessed by that object, that conceptual content, is indeed essential to that knowing. When the status attaches to something else, a straight stick representation, it's in a straightforward sense a different knowing. What object, here crucially being used, he's talking about the object, is the conceptual content. Conceptual content, the bent stick thing. That's the object that's essential to the knowing. And when that knowing changes status from not being to consciousness how things are in themselves, but only to consciousness what things are for consciousness, that object, the status of that conceptual content, changes. That's the point of that puzzling passage. What object, here crucially in the sense of what conceptual content it attaches to, is essential to its being that knowing. If a different object in the sense of conceptual content, it would be a different knowing. altering the knowing by endorsing a different incompatible content alters the status of the original content, and in that sense alters the object associated with the original knowing. Its status changes from being a conceptual content that's endorsed to being one that's rejected. Now, Hegel could have avoided confusion here, either by not introducing this new sense of objective knowledge as referring to a candidate's knower's conceptual content rather than what it represents, or at least by explaining how he's using object here. But he doesn't. He leaves it to us to figure this out. So then, the first originally surprising claim becomes so no longer. The second surprising claim is one that Hegel himself flags as such. He says, quote, "In this presentation of the course of experience, there's a moment in virtue of which it does not seem to be in agreement with the ordinary use of the term experience. This moment is the transition from the first object and the knowledge of that object to the other object. Although it's said that the experience is made in this other object, here the transition has been presented in such a way that the knowledge of the first object, or the being for consciousness of the first in itself, is seen to become the second object itself. By contrast, it usually seems that we somehow discover another object in a manner quite accidental and extraneous, and that we experience in it the untruth of our first concept. What would fall to us on this ordinary view of experience is therefore simply the pure apprehension of what exists in and for itself. From the viewpoint of the present investigation, however, the new object shows itself as having come into being through an inversion of consciousness itself." Close quote, written passage. We're in paragraph 87. Here Hegel is explicitly acknowledging that there's a danger of being misled by the way he's described the experience of error. He explicitly confirms the reading that we've been considering. The second, the new true object, is, he says, the being for consciousness of the first in itself, what it is to consciousness. What he calls the inversion of consciousness is just a change of status of the stick is bent propositional content from being endorsed as reality to being rejected as mere appearance. His surprising claim is that this element of experience, the unmasking of what one had taken to present reality, as in itself, in fact, a mere appearance, a representation that's a misrepresentation, that's the transformation that's the centrally important one. He's saying on the change of status of that conceptual content, the stick is bent, focus on the change of status, what it is to consciousness, from being to consciousness what things are in themselves, to its being to consciousness only what things are for consciousness. Don't focus on the shift from the bent stick commitment to the straight stick commitment. The new object, that is the conceptual content we're led to endorse, indeed prompts the experience of error. But if we focus on the event that contingently occasions the process that is the experience, Hegel is saying, we'll miss what's necessary and essential to that process. And that something is a doing of ours, a change in our commitments in the exercise of our discursive task responsibility. The new way of thinking about experience that he's recommending is really the major point of the whole introduction. And it's what makes possible the narrative that then occupies the rest of the phenomenology. Focusing on the distinctive inversion of consciousness by which what was to the subject, the way things are in themselves, is unmasked as merely how things were for consciousness, is what will give us, Hegel's reader, a phenomenological insight that's not part of the experience of error of the phenomenal consciousness that we'll consider in the rest of the book. The passage above continues, quote, "This way of observing the subject matter is our contribution, we the phenomenological consciousness, the philosophers, looking on. It does not exist for the consciousness that we observe, this focus on the change of status of the conceptual content, the bent stick. That's us. We're thinking, say, that's the important thing, that change of status, that thing that we do when we withdraw our endorsement. But when viewed in this way, the sequence of experiences constituted by consciousness is raised to the level of a scientific progression. End of that quote from 87. This shift of perspective is what makes possible what he calls the science of the experience of consciousness, which I'll remind you is the working title with which Hegel began the project of writing that would become the phenomenology. That was still the title he had in mind when he wrote the introduction to it. The particular commitments, acknowledgement of whose material incompatibility initiates a process of experience, are contingent. What's necessary about that process is the acknowledgement of error and the subsequent disillusionment that it leads to. What's necessary is, quote, the movement, which is cognition, the transforming of that in itself into that which is for itself, as Hegel says at the very end of the book. At this point in our story, we understand what that movement is, but not yet why it's the key to the science of the experience of consciousness. And that's what I want to talk about in the next portion of this lecture. Hegel tells us that the key to understanding the significance of the change in perspectives he's urging is to think through the significance for the threat of skepticism, of the role of what's made explicit in experience by the concept of determinate negation. And this question came up at the end of the question period last time. Gee, if the way to understand the representational relations exclusively in terms of error, aren't we back in the realm of skepticism and not getting to the genuine knowledge condition and the idea that we can actually know how things are? Aren't we in the realm of skepticism? And isn't this account of the disillusionment of our commitments as the core of experience, doesn't that put us back into skepticism? The penultimate paragraph of the introduction continues, quote, as a matter of fact, the circumstance which guides this way of observing is the same as the one previously discussed with regard to the relationship between the present inquiry and skepticism. In every case, the result which emerges from an untrue mode of knowledge must not be allowed to dissolve into an empty nothingness, but must of necessity be grasped as the nothingness of that whose result it is. His emphasis, a result which contains what is true in the previous knowledge. So what is it that's retained that was true in the previous knowledge? It's that it was just what things were for consciousness. That's the truth. Within the present context, this circumstance, still quote, this circumstance manifests itself as follows. When that which at first appeared as the object sinks to the level of being to consciousness, a knowledge of the object. And when the in itself becomes a being for consciousness of the in itself, then this is the new object. End of the quote. I think we've put ourselves in a position to understand this final sentence about how the change of normative status the judgeable content undergoes when the subject withdraws a previous endorsement. What he called this inversion of consciousness, something done, not something that happens to you, is intelligible as the emergence of a new object. That is, that conceptual content as now merely understood merely as a representation, merely as an appearance. But what does that have to do with the attitude we should take towards skepticism? This issue arises because of the expository trajectory that we've traversed. In my first lecture, I claimed that we should read the opening of the introduction as concerned that epistemological skepticism not be forced on us already by our semantics. The more specific diagnosis was that skepticism will be forced on us if we construe the relation between appearance and reality as one in which conceptually contentful representings confront non-conceptually structured representatives across what then looms as a gulf of intelligibility. I claim further that Hegel's proposed therapy, gestured at in the introduction and developed in the consciousness chapters, is to identify conceptual contentfulness with determinateness and to understand determinateness in terms of a special kind of negation. That kind of negation in question, determinate negation, corresponds to Aristotelian contraries, not contradictories, which would be understood in terms of formal or abstract negation. The determinateness of a thought or state of affairs, a predicate or a property, is a matter of its modally robust exclusion of other thoughts or states of affairs, those it's materially incompatible with. This conception allows Hegel to endorse another central Spinoza's doctrine, that the order and connection of things is the same as the order and connection of ideas. But this notion of determinateness applies equally to things and thoughts, representatives and representatives. No gulf of intelligibility is excavated between appearance and reality. Determinate thoughts and determinate states of affairs are, as determinate, both conceptually contentful and hence in principle intelligible. So, the thought was, epistemological skepticism is not built into the semantics at the outset. In this context, there's no reason not to consider the semantic relation between appearance and reality in representational terms. But understanding conceptual content in terms of the content of determinate negation does not just allow such a representational construal. In Hegel's hands, it makes possible a constructive analysis of the representational dimension it finds to be implicit in conceptual content. Hegel combines this fundamental aspect of Spinoza's thought, the structural isomorphism of the order and connection of things and ideas, construed here in terms of relations of determinate negation, he combines that with a Kantian idea that Spinoza did not have. For Spinoza did not appreciate the distinctive normative character of the order and connection of ideas, which distinguishes it from the order and connection of things. Hegel's synthesis of Spinoza with Kant depends on Kant's grounding of semantics and pragmatics. It depends on his account of what one must do in order to take responsibility for a judgeable conceptual content. The key in Hegel's reading of understanding experience as something we do rather than something that happens to us. It's a matter of the normative status of previous commitments. In my second lecture, I rehearsed how Hegel's account of the experience of error, what he makes of Kant's critical integrative task responsibility in synthesizing a constellation of commitments that has the rational unity distinctive of that perception, how that underwrites an implicit practical grasp of representational purport. Downstream from Kant, Hegel's conception of determinate negation accordingly incorporates an essentially dynamic element. It arises out of the crucial residual asymmetry between the order and connection of ideas and of things. It's impossible for one object simultaneously to exhibit materially incompatible properties, while it's only inappropriate for one subject simultaneously to endorse materially incompatible commitments. Representings are articulated by deontic normative relations, while representatives are articulated by alethic modal ones. Finding oneself with materially incompatible commitments obliges one to do something, to revise those commitments so as to remove the incoherence. It's only in terms of that obligation to repair that we can understand what it is to take or treat two objective properties or states of affairs as incompatible in the alethic modal sense. So understanding the representational dimension of conceptual content, the relation and connection between the deontic and alethic limbs of the cognitive practical constellation of subjective and objective, requires understanding how the experience of error articulated in normative terms, is intelligible as the representation of objective alethic modal relations of incompatibility. Unlike Spinoza's, Hegel's concept of determinate negation is Janus-based, displaying the subjective and objective aspects that are complementary in the sense of being reciprocally sense-dependent. On the side of the subject, the normative significance of negation is pragmatic. It yields an obligation to movement, change, development. Determinate negation, material incompatibility, mediates the relation between pragmatics and semantics. as well as the relation between the expressive and the representational dimensions of intentionality on the semantic side. But the revelation that the semantogenic core of experience is the experience of error, that its essence consists in the unmasking of something as not real, but as mere appearance, seems to raise once more the specter of skepticism. If error is the necessary form of experience, if what one implicitly discovers in experience is always the incorrectness and inadequacy of one's knowledge or understanding, then why is not skepticism the right conclusion to draw? Why has not Hegel's own concept of experience shown itself to be, in his words, the path of despair? Hegel wants to understand the relation between the two objects, the first in itself and the being for consciousness of that in itself, as one of negation. Quote, this new object contains the nothingness, the Nichtigkeit of the first. It is what experience is made of it. So we have that one conceptual content, the bent stick, and experience changes, is our changing the status of that, from its being to consciousness what things are in itself, to its being to consciousness merely what it was for consciousness. That new object, he says, contains the nothingness of the first. It's what experience is made of it. That's from 86. The idea is that skepticism consists in taking the sense in which the second object is the negation of the first to be formal or abstract negation rather than determinate negation. That's what, in the middle paragraphs of the introduction, was his diagnosis of where skepticism was wrong. Doing that is, quote, allowing the result which emerges from an untrue mode of knowledge, quote, to, quote, dissolve into empty nothingness, close quote. The point is that the sense in which the second object contains the nothingness of the first is not that the stick is bent, is succeeded by the stick is not bent. It's that it's succeeded by the realization that the stick is bent is not saying how things really are. Instead, that's an appearance, a misrepresentation of a straight stick. That's the materially incompatible commitment for which the bent stick representation was discarded, changing its normative status. The original commitment is not revealed by its incorrectness as an appearance, not just as an appearance, but as the appearance of a reality. It's genuinely an appearance of that reality, a way that reality showed up for consciousness. It's wrong, but it's not simply wrong. It's a path to the truth. This isn't a picture where we're in danger of a skepticism that has us completely unconnected to what we're thinking about. Rather, it's revealed as an appearance of a reality. Yes, an appearance, it's not how things are in themselves, it's an appearance of a straight stick. When Hegel says, quote, the result which emerges from an untrue mode of knowledge must be, quote, grasped as the nothingness of that whose result it is, a result which contains what is true in the previous knowledge, close quote. This is true in a double sense. First, the original take on things is not simply canceled, leaving a void as a bare contradiction would be. It's replaced by a contrary substantive commitment, one that's materially and not merely formally incompatible with it. Something positive has been learned. The stick is straight. Second, the transition from the original object to the second true object, not now from the bent stick to the straight stick, but the change of status of the bent stick commitment, the transition from the original object to the second new true object is a change of status from a propositional attitude ascribable to the subject de dicta to one ascribable also de re. Where before we and the subject could say, S believes that the stick is bent, after the experience of error and the rejection of the original endorsement in favor of a materially contrary one, that very same attitude is ascribable as S believes of a straight stick that it is bent. That's the point of the analysis of representational purport and its uptake in terms of the experience of error that I talked about last time. The transformation of status is a rejection of a prior endorsement, but it's not just a rejection of it. In an important sense, it's an enrichment of its content as it becomes to the subject a claim about something. The representational dimension of its conceptual content becomes manifest. It becomes something to consciousness, albeit by being revealed as a misrepresentation. As we saw in the first lecture, the unintelligibility of the representational dimension is characteristic of the semantically rooted epistemological skepticism that Hegel diagnoses in the opening paragraphs of the introduction. It's no surprise at this point, then, to learn that skepticism's characteristic default is a failure to appreciate the role of determinate negation in extracting consequences from the experience of error. He says, quote, "The presentation of untrue consciousness in its untruth is not merely a negative movement, as natural consciousness one-sidedly views it. And a mode of knowledge which makes this one-sidedness its basic principle is the skepticism which sees in every result only a pure nothingness and abstracts from the fact that this nothingness is determinate, that is the nothingness of that from which it results. In fact, it's only when nothingness is taken as the nothingness of what it comes from that it's the true result. For then nothingness itself is a determinate nothingness and has a content. The skepticism which ends up with the abstraction of nothingness or with emptiness cannot proceed any further, but must wait to see whether anything new presents itself to it, and what this is, in order to cast it into the same abysmal void. But if, on the contrary, the result is comprehended as it truly is, as determinate negation, then a new form has thereby immediately arisen." That long quote from 79, from the middle of the introduction. Only from the point of view he's recommending can we make sense of the fact that in each experience of error, something positive is learned. One of the pieces of the puzzle and of Hegel's solution that I hope to have added here is the understanding of how the representational dimension of conceptual content, no less than the expressive dimension, becomes intelligible in terms of the essential constitutive role that determinate negation plays in the process of experience. Still, we can ask, why doesn't Hegel's account of experience as the experience of error, as the unmasking of what we took to be reality as appearance, as the revelation of what was to subjects, the way things are in themselves, as merely how they are for consciousness, provide exactly the premise needed for a fallibilist meta-induction? The fallibilist meta-induction is the inference that starts with the observation that every belief we've had or judgment we've made has eventually turned out to be false, at least in detail. Think of the history of science. And it concludes that every belief or judgment we ever will or even could have will similarly eventually be found wanting if we've been subjected to sufficient critical scrutiny. Early on in the introduction, Hegel tells us that this skeptical conclusion is a natural one for those who have not learned the lessons he's teaching us. He says, quote, "Natural consciousness will show itself to be merely the concept of knowledge, or unreal knowledge. But since it immediately takes itself to be real knowledge, this pathway has a negative significance for it. And what is actually the realization of the concept is for it rather the loss and destruction of itself. For on this road, it loses its truth. The road may thus be viewed as the path of doubt, or more properly, as the path of despair. This road is the conscious insight into the untruth of phenomenal knowledge." That's from paragraph 78, end of the quote. What one needs to learn to see, and what one needs to learn to see that this is the wrong conclusion, is the central semantic significance of the experience of error for the intelligibility of the representational dimension of conceptual content. But to understand the positive significance of the unmasking of commitments as determinately mistaken, as misrepresentations since corrected, a substantive new conception of truth is required. That conception is developed in the body of the phenomenology and only hinted at in the introductory material. It is foreshadowed, however, already in the preface. He says there, quote, "Truth includes the negative also. What would be called the false if it could be regarded as something from which one might abstract? The evanescent itself must, on the contrary, be regarded as essential, not as something fixed, cut off from the true. Appearance is the arising and passing away that does not itself arise and pass away, but is in itself and constitutes actuality and the movement of the life of truth." End of the quote. Instead of thinking of truth as an achievable state or status, Hegel wants us to think of it as characteristic of a process, the process of experience, in which appearances arise and pass away. They arise as appearances taken as veridical, ways things are for consciousness, that are endorsed, that are to consciousness, how they are in themselves. When they're found to be materially incompatible with other commitments in the experience of error, some of them are actively rejected. A transformation of status, something we do, that is the arising of the second new true object. That very same contact, as an appearance, as a misrepresentation, becoming to consciousness only how things are for consciousness. This process of weighing the credentials of competing commitments to determine which should be retained and which altered, so as to remove local material incompatibilities, is the process by which we find out more about how things are. That passage from the preface continues with a famous image. The true is thus a vast Bacchanalian revel, with not a member sober. Yet because each member collapses as soon as he drops out, the revel is just as much transparent and simple repose. End of the quote. The revel is the restless elbowing of commitments discovered to be incompatible. Those that drop out, the image of the drunken revelers falling beneath the table, those that drop out are those that undergo the transformation of experience and are rejected in order to maintain the rational homeostasis that Hegel identifies as a state of simple repose. That's what Kant talked about as the rational synthetic unity of our perception. The party continues its movement and development because the place of those that fall away is immediately taken by other commitments. This axial passage from the preface continues in a way that introduces the three themes with which I want to end my discussion. He says, quote, "Judged in the court of this movement, the single shapes of spirit do not persist any more than determinate thoughts do. But they are as much positive and necessary movements as they are negative and evanescent. In the whole of the movement, seen as a state of repose, what distinguishes itself therein and gives itself particular existence is preserved as something that recollects itself, whose existence is self-knowledge, and whose self-knowledge is just as immediately existence." End quote. First, the truth process, whose structure is that of the experience of error, is the process by which conceptual contents develop and are determined. It's not just the process by which judgments are selected, but also the process by which concepts evolve. It's the process in and through which more and more of how the world really is, what's actually materially incompatible with what, in the objective alethic sense, becomes incorporated in material incompatibilities deontically acknowledged by subjects. For one's response to the acknowledged incompatibility of two commitments one finds oneself with, often is to adjust one's commitments concerning what's incompatible with what, and so what follows from what. If my initial concept of an acid obliges me to apply it to any liquid that tastes sour, and applying it commits me in turn that the liquid turns litmus paper red, I may respond to a sour liquid that turns litmus paper blue, and to the incompatibility of those two color commitments, not by rejecting either the perceptual judgment of sourness or the perceptual judgment of blue, but by revising the norms articulating my concept. I might, for instance, take it that only clear liquids that taste sour are acids, or that cloudy acids don't turn liquids paper red. It's because, insofar as they inherit the results of many such experiences of error, that the normatively articulated conceptual contents subjects acknowledge and deploy track the objective modal conceptual articulation of the world as well as they did. That's why the experience of error is a truth process. The second point is that Hegel's invocation of recollection, Erinnerung is his word, to which he returns at the very end of the phenomenology, is a gesture at the third phase of the experience of error. We've already considered the first two. Acknowledging the material incompatibility of some of one's commitments and revising one's commitments, including those concerning what's incompatible with God, so as to repair the discordance. What Hegel calls recollection is a subsequent rational reconstruction of the extended process of experience that's led to one's current constellation of commitments. What's reconstructed is a sequence of episodes, each of which exhibits the three-phase structure of acknowledgement, repair, and recollection of materially incompatible commitments one has endorsed. From the actual process of past experience, the recollector selects a trajectory that's exhibited as expressively progressive. That is, as having the form of a gradual cumulative revelation of how things really are, according to the recollector at that stage. It's a Whiggish story, characteristic of old-fashioned histories of science, of how the way things are in themselves came to be the way they've veridically appeared for consciousness. And in this way, the past is constantly turned into a history. Differently with each tripartite episode of experience is how Hegel understands reason as retrospectively giving contingency the form of necessity, as he says. The third point is that the recollection phase of experience is a crucial element in what Hegel calls the science of the experience of consciousness. So far in these lectures, I've talked a lot about the experience of consciousness, but not officially about the science of the experience of consciousness. And this might well have led to some puzzlement. Why am I talking about the role and experience of mundane concepts like mensch and straight stick, when the book Hegel is introducing us to focuses exclusively on concepts such as consciousness, self-consciousness, and agency? That is, cognitive authority, the social institution of authority, and practical authority. Why have I been discussing the development of constellations of judgments and concepts when Hegel was concerned, at least in the second half of the introduction, as in the phenomenology as a whole, with the development of what he calls shapes of consciousness? Such questions, while understandable, are, I think, misplaced. Though I've not explicitly been talking about it, what I've been doing is an exercise in the science of the experience of consciousness. For that science is the explicit, systematic, self-conscious understanding of the experience of consciousness. I take it that any understanding of Hegel, or indeed of Kant, must start with what he has to teach us about ordinary, ground-level, empirical, and practical experience. For Hegel, as for Kant, that's a matter of applying what Hegel calls determinate concepts. These are concepts like stick and straight, and blue and sour. What Hegel calls speculative or logical concepts are theoretical philosophical meta-concepts, whose distinctive expressive role it is to make explicit features of the conceptual contents and the use, the semantics and pragmatics, of those ground-level concepts. The phenomenology is a story about the development of those higher-level concepts in terms of which his readers, the phenomenological consciousness, can be brought to comprehend discursive activity in general, phenomenal consciousness. The measure of our understanding of what he has to say on that topic lies principally in the sense we can use those concepts to make of the whole constellation of conceptually articulated normative practice and institutions that Hegel calls Geist. That's why I've started my story with what I take it he wants us ultimately to understand about the experience of consciousness. Then, and only then, once we understand what he wants to say about the development of ground-level concepts, we can consider what it is to render the development of either kind of concept, determinate concepts or speculative concepts, in scientific terms, in Hegel's sense of that term. To do that is to tell a certain kind of retrospective, rationally reconstructive story about their development, one that displays an expressively progressive history made out of that past experience. This is the third phase of the process of experience, which is initiated by the acknowledgement of the material incompatibility of some commitments, proceeds through their local and temporary resolution of that incoherence by relinquishing or modifying some commitments, including those concerning what's materially incompatible with or a consequence of what, while retaining others, and culminates in comprehending the experience by situating it as the current result of a process in which previous commitments show up as ever more revelatory, but still ultimately inadequate, appearances for consciousness of what one now takes things are in themselves. The capstone of Hegel's account, at the end of the Reason chapter, and further at the end of the Spirit chapter, will be to show us how this retrospective, rationally reconstructive, genealogical phase of the process of experience means that such experience is at once both the further determining of the content of concepts, whether determinate or speculative concepts, in the sense of the expressive dimension of conceptual content, that intentionality, that is articulated by relations of determinate negation, and at the same time the discerning of reference, the Deutungen, what things are in themselves that are represented by such senses. Senses, Sinne, what things are for consciousness, along the representational dimension of conceptual content. Of intentionality out of that intentionality, as articulated by the process that is the experience of error, normatively governed by relations of determinate negation. But that's a story for another occasion. Hegel thinks that the only form of theoretical comprehension of the conceptual and representational content of a concept can take is such a genealogy of the process of experience by which it's determined. And this is true whether what's being addressed is a constellation of concepts and commitments at the meta level of scientific self-consciousness or at the ground level of empirical consciousness. That's why he assimilates them in the preface passage I cited a minute ago. That's why he says, quote, judged in the court of this movement, the single shapes of spirit do not persist any more than determinate thoughts do. Single shapes of spirit at the matter level, and the determinate thoughts at the ground level. But they are as much positive and necessary movements as they are negative and evanescent. A proper meta-level account of the experience of self-consciousness is a science of the experience of ground-level consciousness. The phenomenology recounts the experience of the science of the experience of consciousness. The process by which meta-concepts he takes to be adequate to comprehend explicitly the process of experience are themselves developed and determined. We see Hegel asserting that the experience of error as here described is also the mechanism whereby new shapes of consciousness arise in a passage we're now, I hope, in a position to appreciate. He says, quote, when that which at first appeared as the object sinks to the level of being to consciousness, a knowledge of the object, and when the in itself becomes a being for consciousness of the in itself, then this is the new object. And with this new object, a new shape of consciousness also makes its appearance, a shape to which the essence is something different from that which was the essence to the preceding shape. It is this circumstance which guides the entire succession of the shapes of consciousness in its necessity. But it is this necessity alone, or the emergence of the new object presenting itself to consciousness without the latter knowing how this happens to it, which occurs for us, as it were, behind its back. A moment which is both in itself and for us is thereby introduced into the movement of consciousness, a movement which does not present itself for the consciousness engaged in the experience itself. But the content of what we see emerging exists for it, and we comprehend only the formal aspect of what emerges for its pure emerging. For consciousness, what has emerged exists only as an object. For us, it exists at once as a movement and a becoming. This, then, is the necessity in virtue of which the present road towards science is itself already a science. And in accordance with its content, it may be called the science of the experience of consciousness. End the quote in 87. In these three lectures, I focused on what Hegel will have to say about the semantics and pragmatics of the concepts deployed and determined through base-level experience by way of preparation for understanding the course of the experience of meta-level self-consciousness that he recollects for us in the body of the phenomenology.